See, this is work in progress. We usually say that to deflect attention from the paper itself, but I'm still thinking through these issues of minimalism, so we'll see. So the minimalist impulse in African musical creation. Creativity. Among the wonders of African creativity is the ability of certain individuals to spin large tracts of musical thought from a minimum of resources, two or three pitches, a pair of contrasting timbres, or nuggets of distinctly shaped rhythms. This minimalist impulse is widespread throughout Africa, and it is the aim of this talk to lay bare a few of its enabling mechanisms. I plan to do three things. First, I want to contrast aspects of Western minimalism with African minimalism. Second, I want to illustrate the sound of African minimalism through recorded examples. And third, I'm going to subject one neo-traditional composition from the Ewe Bobobo repertoire to closer analysis. Anyone familiar with traditional African music will readily call to mind styles and idioms animated by extensive or even obsessive repetition. Insofar as the minimalist manner is constituted by repetition, I'm not saying anything new here, nor am I saying anything controversial. What may be new, and what I'm hoping will bring us insight, is thinking through these familiar repertoires once again as intentional actions motivated by a minimalist aesthetic. In other words, I want to make explicit through denomination the minimalism that has been implicit all along in African musical studies. So, Western minimalism versus African minimalism. Now, using the word minimalist immediately awakens comparisons with the movement known as minimalism in Western art music. One of the most notable developments, I'm using Keith Potter's words here, one of the most notable developments in a late 20th century musical culture. Western minimalism emerged in the 1960s and 70s in painting, sculpture, literature, and music. Its first generation included composers like Lamonte Young, Terry Riley, Steve Reich, Philip Glass. Although their styles are internally diversified, minimalists share a commitment to repudiating the values of complexity and alienation associated with musical modernism and replacing them with an accessible style based on the essences of musical material. Or so goes the conventional narrative. The means include a foregrounding of repetition, in other words, using repetition not only as structural necessity, but as a rhetorical option, and motivic saturation. Now, there are parallels as well as divergences between Western and African minimalism, and I don't actually have time to address these fully, but I would like to make two points, one systematic, the other historical. And by the way, the designation Western minimalism, of course, covers multifarious practices and will need to be refined in a more detailed comparison with African minimalism. That is to say, we might speak of European minimalism, American minimalism, post-minimalism, and so on. So I can't get into those complexities here. So the systematic point is one of similarity. Just as Western minimalism encompassed other arts, so African minimalism displays affinities with the visual arts. Art historian Robert Farris Thompson and musicologist Meki Nzewi have both put forward conceptual parallels between visual and temporal art that are suggestive. The unfolding of overall design in Mande-related country cloths, for example, is likened to a vibrant propensity for offbeat phrasing. That's Robert Farris Thompson's phrase. Just as the patterning of narrow strip textiles is evocative of interlocking patterns in musical execution. Now, because interlocking typically involves two separate patterns entering into each other's spaces and doing so with impunity, it is not hard to see how this technique can be interpreted as modeling a form of minimalism. The point is not that African musical minimalism originated from non-musical arts, but that analogous processes of minimalist structuring may be discerned in both music and visual art. The historical point, also the more significant, is one of difference. Unlike Western minimalism, which arose at a very specific historical moment and in reaction to a recent past of compositional activity, in a long parenthesis here, that past includes the modernist revolution of the earlier decades of the 20th century, expressionism, serialism with its structures and strictures, the emergence of other streams of music, including jazz, rock, and popular music, and last but not least, the greater visibility in the West of non-Western music through ethnographic recordings, and the subsequent emergence of the phenomenon of world music. That was one long parenthesis. And that's the history of 20th century music in a parenthesis, right? So unlike Western minimalism, African minimalism has a much older and largely unwritten history. With a little poetic license, we might say that minimalism was there in the beginning, that it coincided with the earliest manifestations of music making. Of course, we can only speculate on such ultimate origins, but my point is that African minimalism was not a reaction to the perceived excesses of a prior modernism. Composers were in no way expressing dissatisfaction with past practices. Rather, the minimalist impulse was manifest at birth, almost as a gift. To make music was always already to adopt a minimalist mode, it would seem. Western artists thus came to discover something that had existed in Africa for the longest time, something that defined an African compositional mode with its roots in language and dance. That this discovery was made in the political, economic, social, and intellectual climate of the 1960s is no accident, as the example of Steve Reich makes clear. By embracing repetition, Western minimalists were surely embracing the oldest trick in the trade. It remained only to acknowledge that here, as in other realms of creativity, Africa once led the way. Well, what is this sound that once led the way? And I have another long parenthesis here just because I think, I thought somebody would ask me about this. So it has to do with vocabulary. So I'll come back to answer that question in a minute, but a word about vocabulary. So some of you, of course, may be wondering whether the concept of minimalism is found in African languages. Now, while no single term for minimalism has so far emerged in Black African discourses about music, there's a plethora of terms that index qualities of minimality. So in the Ewe lexicon, for example, there are terms for minimum, enu swe swe, smallness, swe no no, essence, enua unto, cogent, ziji, and limit, sefe. The opposing term, maximalism, is also missing from metalinguistic designation of musical practice. But again, there are terms in indigenous languages for maximum, nusi enye luluto, infinite mavo, wide or flowing vlaya, grand ga or lulu, and superlative, sobowu wokata. And if you want to look at Westermann's 1928 Dictionary of the Ewe Language, you'll find some of these words in it. So when making comparisons like these, one should remember that absence is less an indication of a deficiency and more a sign of alternative distribution of qualities and priorities. African vocabularies associated with music making, so Amos and King, 1971, or Lester Montz, 1990, or a little article by Misonu Amu, 1997, giving examples of African vocabulary. So African vocabularies associated with music making typically capture two things, names of instruments and genres, and performance actions. Thus, a more abstract term like minimalism, designed to capture a range of individual practices, is less likely to appear unless elicited sometimes by an ethnographer, imposed from the outside, or self-consciously cultivated by an eager or ambitious group leader. The point about designation then is simply that although the verbal economies surrounding performance are not loaded with minimalism and its synonyms, qualities essential to that term are easily conveyed. Okay, so that's just a word about vocabulary, and if you're interested, we can talk about it. So go back to my question, what is the sound that once led the way? So the sound of African minimalism. I've assembled brief excerpts from longer performances to illustrate different styles of African minimalism. These are listed in your handout in example one. And I hope you can see my handout because it will be useful towards the end of the talk especially. So I'm just going to invite you to listen closely to each of these examples. I will not be unveiling any hidden technical features. I'm interested only in the immediately hearable aspects. Now, I remind you that none of this music was ever written down. It is lodged in the memories of its performers, many of whom are non-specialists. This music is made as part of daily life, ritual, and entertainment, and as such, has strong claims to a register of ordinariness or unmarkedness. And the material support for music making is modest: stones, pieces of wood, leaves, human voices, human hands, and bells. What I hope you will consider is that if this is ordinary, what might the extraordinary look like? So first, my first example, and these are all in example one. So Togolese lithophone player Kpalandao Yuriyao invokes a popular rhythm, Kaleta, in this performance. Okay, it goes on like that. So, pulse-oriented, the composition is texturally continuous, even though the individual sounds die soon after each stone is struck. Notable here are emergent motifs and an overall illusion that we are hearing several players instead of just one. Second, a second example. This one is a lullaby from, sorry, I'm going to go briskly through these examples. In the original version of this paper, I had 20 of them, but if I played all 20, we would be here for a very long time. So I'm only playing you a selection. Yeah. So a second one, this is a lullaby from the Nkundo of the DRC. Now, our female singer has selected two adjacent pitches as anchors or resting points for a more extended discourse. Between appearances of this dyad, the remaining members of the ruling pentatonic set are used to spin short melodic statements. And you'll notice a gentle clapping of hands that adds a measure of metrical control in spite of the declamatory ambience. That second example was a lullaby from the Nkundo of the Democratic Republic of the Congo. And it basically, it does, ya da da di ya, ya 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 di ta, da 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 di da di da ya di ta. And so on, comes back to those two notes, right? Those are the two adjacent notes that I was suggesting function as a kind of resting point for a more extended discourse. And I was going to point out that there is an interesting process as far as the pulses are concerned here, which is a pattern of 4 plus 5 plus 4 plus 6 plus 4 plus 6 plus 6 plus 5 plus 8 plus 7 plus 6 plus 6 plus 6 plus 6 plus 5. Which you can, of course, remember easily. Now, my next example is also misbehaving, so I'll just tell you what it is. It's a Ugandan bow harpist, Tumeseo Mukasa, who is featured playing an eight-stringed enanga in this performance. The pitch resource here is pentatonic. The singer player starts by rapidly vocalizing a series of syllables as if imitating the sound of playing. So this kind of iconism, by the way, is a very well-known feature of African expression. Now, the constancy of the pentatonic resource and the digital mode of articulation reinforce the minimalist ambience. Let me go on to the next one. This will be example four. So this is an Akaze greeting performed by two Burundian girls. In this fascinating genre of greeting and exchanging news, performers share a temporal constraint and pitch reference, but employ different motifs in conveying their individual messages. The rapid syllabic enunciation may be heard as an analog to the enanga or the lithophone articulations heard earlier on. These are the two Burundian girls. So this next one, which will be example five, is a slightly unusual instrument. It's, see if you can tell what it is. Oh, I already told you. Sorry, yeah. So this is a vibrating leaf. The player, who is a 9-year-old Angolan boy, wants to see what volume of sound he can conjure up by blowing his leaf. The resulting sonic traces are variable. The 12 segment lengths, the 12 of them, are similar, but pitch is bent in subsequent soundings. And the 10th, if you had heard that, yields no sound at all. That's why you didn't hear it. This way of stripping things down to a bare but interesting minimum is characteristic of children's play songs throughout the continent. Now, by the way, those of you who just decided that the vibrating leaf is not music may wish to remember that our precocious composer is doing nothing but exploring sound for its sake, having fun. But haven't you heard sounds like this in Euro-American avant-garde music? I can think of passages in some of John Cage's prepared piano pieces that are indistinguishable from some xylophone music, or moments in Chelsea's Canti del Capricorno that compare with the lamentation of a Dan woman, or places in Meredith Monk's Our Lady of Fate, which may remind us of some pygmy singing. Taken simply as streams of sounding forms, some traditional African music approximates the sounding forms of some European avant-garde music. Differences lie in performer intention and cost of production. This particular affinity has not yet been packaged, however. Okay, going on to the next example, number six. This one features minimality in the form of a drone. Let me see if this one works. Okay, this one works. It's a drone, yeah? Okay, the chorus of Wudabe Pels sings and sustains first a single pitch class, it's an extended pedal point that is reinforced triadically from time to time. This gesturing towards infinity, if you like, by cultivating a continuous rather than broken sound represents one extreme of minimalist procedure. And just for the record, the Pels were doing this long before Lamont Young's Trio for Strings, 1958. With its long sustained notes. My seventh example. So micro level articulation returns in this next excerpt, which features Makondere horns from Uganda. And you'll hear stacked ostinatos, emergent patterns, and an overall sense of ongoingness which combine to convey the minimalist aesthetic. This is example 8. So this is a xylophone performance from Chad, in which ostinato patterns in interlocking alignment allow listeners to focus on different melodic resultants, even while the whole is regulated periodically. Of course, xylophone and imbira music generally are most readily affined with early minimalism. So this is what that one sounds like, 8. And another example, this is example 9 from the Ubangi group of the DRC. This one features a man singing to the accompaniment of a 6-stringed harp known as kundi. A single prolonged chord serves as backdrop to his narrative, which is delivered in a rapid, quasi-declamatory style. The deliberately restricted melodic range and the syllabic articulation reinforce the speech-like character of the singing, while the rhythmically active but harmonically fixed accompaniment contributes a minimalist aura. If you heard this, you would hear about 57 cycles in this performance, but you're not gonna hear it. Okay, and the last example, this is from a well-known CD by the so-called Pan-African Orchestra. This is an explicitly sourced piece, Minson. This performance, as you will hear in a minute, begins, as you may hear in a minute, so I have to edit my paper as I go along, so. Ah, okay, so you do hear this. So it begins with a bell, as you heard. I will add another bell, and then by an incremental process, incorporate elephant horns, hand claps, small drums, and finally the large fantom drums in a mellow rhythmic feast. The constancy of distinct patterns conveys a minimalist aura, and here there will be, some 11 iterations, well, a factor of 11 iterations of the timeline. I'll play you a little bit of this. This is the 10th example. So just a bell first, and then a second bell. And that's the timeline that you're hearing all the way through. The elephant horn, hand clap, drum. Drums. And then the call and the response. Response. Okay, so let me just draw a few preliminary conclusions from listening to these excerpts. First, repetition is the key signifier of a minimalist impulse, exact rather than varied, structural as well as rhetorical. It occurs at different levels of structure and often supports a polyrhythmic texture. Second, African minimalism ranges from a foregrounded, pulse-oriented mode of articulation to one in which the pulse is hidden. Placing the pulse in your face, as in the first example you heard, confers a present orientation on the musical discourse, whereas hidden pulses suggest a more future-oriented discourse. Pulse orientation is often associated with play, whereas period orientation often accompanies declamation, narration, or the exposition of verbal content. Third, the minimalist instinct is equally evident in vocal and instrumental music. Yeah, it sounds like an obvious point, but it's actually not so trivial. If you imagine the energy of vocal singing also doing the minimalist thing that you associate with you know, minimalist composer. So the beating of the voice, that's what I mean. So the minimalist instinct is equally evident in vocal and instrumental music, allowing us to fantasize identical deep structures that are then translated, if you like, into different material surfaces. So akahe performances, for example, are syllable-oriented and may be compared to the lithophone or xylophone playing, which is akin to the movement of a millipede's feet. Small proximate steps that come across as unbroken rather than as a succession of discrete points. Now, we've always known about the deep connection between language and music, between music as language and especially language as music, but we haven't always pursued that conjunction on this more abstract level. Fourth, minimalism is constrained by certain ethical and aesthetical imperatives that regulate musical composition in African communities. The most important of these stem from a prevailing communal ethos, which is most readily expressed through dance. Some listeners to African minimalist music are bored because they want to see something happen, and quickly, and following a certain Aristotelian narrative trajectory. However, the emptiness in African minimalism is a strategic invitation to the dance. John Chernoff understood this well in his 1979 book, African Rhythm and African Sensibility, when he said that African music is in principle incomplete without your, that is the listener, the observer's, participation. The ethos is not show me what you can do, but rather let's make music together even as you demonstrate your skill. I would say that the absence of communality is a profound difference between Western and African minimalism, even though earlier Western minimalism affected the pose of communalism. Having now introduced the broad features of African minimalism in a variety of cultures and genres, I will conclude by looking in a little detail at a Bobobo performance, which I'm afraid you're not going to hear, and this really undermines my entire lecture, at least you have some rough transcription in your handout, so you can you'll have some sense of what may be going on. Okay, so let me just tell you a little bit about this genre, Bobobo, before I not play you the music. Now, I'm really learning to use the negatives too very well here. So Bobobo is a popular Northern Ewe recreational dance. This is from Ghana that originated in the late 1950s and early 1960s in the town of Kpando, from where it spread to other Volta region towns and eventually to metropolitan cities like Accra and Tema, including suburbs like Ashaman and Medina. So Bobobo emerged roughly at the same time that American minimalism started, but this is already neo-traditional music. Yeah. It is performed by an ensemble of bells, drums, rattles, and men and women singing voices. Perhaps the most memorable moment in a Bobobo performance is the entrance of a trumpet, or sometimes it's a bugle. The purpose of the trumpet solo is to energize or fan the performance. While drumming and dancing continue, the singing stops to make room for this particular soloistic display. So trumpet interventions are moments of heightened rhetoric. And in my original script, I wrote, here is the beginning of Binwodekane Dunenyolo, this thing that you're not going to hear. Let me just see if the gods are smiling on us now. No. Okay, another corrupted file. That's really a shame. Okay, so to help make sense of Miwodeka, I've assembled a transcription. This is in your example two. That's the back of the handout. And then a list of constituent units. That's the front of your handout, which is example three, and a paradigmatic chart. Okay, so I suggest you just hold on to example two. That's it's going to be take on an amusing turn here as I try to sing some of this trumpet solo, if I can find a handout. Anyway, the essential ingredients of this performance are annunciatory or fanfare-like rising arpeggios, complementary but less extended falling triads, waiting patterns on one or five but never on three, motivic dialogue, and reiterated cadential gestures. Now, these procedures are ordinary, but how are they brought to life? How are they made to support the kind of minimalist creativity that this particular trumpet intervention represents? So what I'd like to do is to follow the course of the melodic discourse from the beginning to the end, and I've labeled the units as Unit 1, Unit 2, Unit 3, Unit 4, and so on. And if you can follow those units in my example too, then what I'll say will be hopefully comprehensible. Is there an extra? Thank you. All right, so I'm just going to pitch this where it feels comfortable, folks. So just and please just be relaxed about everything, okay? Unit 1, pa-pa-da-da-di-da-di-da, and it holds it, right? Okay, so I'll read you the little analysis. Now, beginning gestures are typically loud and attention-grabbing. So Joseph Kwaku, the performer here, arpeggios up to the high F with bravado and holds onto it for 6.5 bars. With this exclamatory opening gesture, the trumpeter maps out the pitch terrain, announces a timbral presence, and energizes the dancers, some of whom may well be thrown into a state of delirium by this phrase. This is only the beginning, however. Unit 2. Let me go on to Unit 3. And so on. Unit 4, this is a shame that you won't hear Unit 5 because it's doubled with the drummers. So they're all doing the same speech rhythm. And so on. I'm really, I can't entertain you any further on that front, but you get some idea of what's going on. Okay, so I read you Unit 1. Unit 2 repeats the opening gesture, but instead of holding on to the top F, Kwaku returns to the low F by means of a complementary arpeggio. So whereas Unit 1 sustained the high F as a rhetorically marked moment, Unit 2 merely touches it several times before returning home, so to speak, to the low F. Unit 3. Now, Unit 3 makes a third attempt at beginning using the same rousing arpeggio figure. This time, Kwaku settles on what we might as well call the tonic in association with the third, so for some six bars. In other words, a B flat and a D. While waiting, the waiting note in Unit 1 was a sustained high F, the waiting signal in Unit 3 is rhythmically active, and it is in this active form that waiting notes or motifs assume greater importance as this composition unfolds. Unit 4 opens with a by now familiar fanfare figure and eventually settles on another waiting pitch, this time scale degree 5, which keeps the sense of the discourse open. Unit 5, this is really the best, the most interesting of the units. Joseph Kwaku introduces a new idea, a falling arpeggio in broad rhythm, which is derivable from Unit 2. He answers it with two other motifs and then repeats himself, and there's a rotation in the form. Noticeably different in Unit 5 is the mode of enunciation, which is perhaps more speech-like than song-like. Unit 5's motifs are briefer, they are set apart by silences. Their succession acquires an interrogative and dialogical aura. You will also notice that the lead drummer speaks alongside the trumpeter in this unit. And now I'm going to just pass very quickly over Unit 6 to 11. Unit 6 returns to the waiting pattern on 5, which is first heard at the end of Unit 4, but resolves this to B flat at its end. Unit 7 prolongs the tonic resolution. Unit 8 provides another rotation of Unit 5, complete with a mellow rhythmic doubling of the trumpet part by the lead drum. Unit 9 is identical to Unit 6. Then, in a recapitulatory gesture, Unit 10 takes up the rising arpeggio of Unit 1, but does not prolong the high F. And finally, Unit 11 again takes the 5-8 gesture of Unit 7 and brings the trumpet solo to an end with a prolonged note. So by way of summary, example 3 on your handout, so you have to go back to the beginning now, on your handout lists lists the individual units from 1 to 11 and ascribes functions to them, right? This is perfectly obvious. If this is a little too obvious, just have some sympathy with me because I teach a lot of undergraduate classes, okay? All right. So example 4 now sketches the overall form using a simple paradigmatic chart that aligns equivalent units and maintains their piece-specific chronology. So this song, composition, improvisation, whatever you want to call it, miwodeka, comes across as a tripartite structure. If you're looking at my example 4, you'll see that units 1, 2, 3, 4 are in one column, right? And then we go across through 4, 5, 6, and 7. So whenever you see that, it means that the thing has become more narrative-like because there's new information. Then we go back over 5 and 6 as 8 and 9, and then eventually to 10 and 11. So you can see that the first column is quite stacked, so to speak. It's a very useful diagram for comparative analysis, really. So you can just see the strategy that's used in different, in this case, different improvisations. Okay, what is, and just to anticipate probably some of the discussion, although I have aligned some of the units, their internal tendencies are also slightly contradictory, okay? So it's not just, it's not a strophic situation where 1, 2, 3, and 4 are the same strophe, but there is, if you like, a dominant characteristic that leads me to put them in the same column. But the internal tendencies are a little more complicated than and that this always happens, I think, when we do this kind of analysis, because you have to make a selection about what you consider to be the dominant feature. Okay. Well, I'm very, very sorry that you can't hear this. Here's the conclusion of my analysis, because you would have now just heard Joseph Kweku play that with the whole Bobobo group. And then I would say, what a feat of imagination using only 3 notes. Joseph Kweku's relatively brief intervention is superbly calibrated to make a strong impact. A rhetorically heightened beginning yields a moment of play and teasing in the middle before briefly returning to the fanfare in conclusion. The minimalist resource is, of course, the pitch resource, but the performer has brought to this a rhythmic imagination, including the invocation of the speech mode that excites his fellow performers and moves his audience. So just to conclude here. So I've tried to demonstrate a core minimalism at the heart of the African compositional mode. The full geocultural extent of African minimalism remains to be established definitively, but a preliminary map would include areas in Uganda, Rwanda, Mozambique, South Africa, Angola, the DRC in particular, Central African Republic, the Gambia, Niger, Togo, the Cote d'Ivoire, and Ghana. The main constructive principle involves inter-domain compensation. This is the only abstract thing I'm saying here, right? Inter-domain compensation, whereby minimality in one domain is offset or compensated for by non-minimality in another. Minimalism takes many forms and attracts a host of values. A digitalized mode animated by persistent repetition is the most prominent form, while an invitation to movement or dance to both supplement and replace the music is its most cherished value. Now, in appropriating the label minimalism to describe these products of the African imagination, I am not unaware of the charges that have been brought against minimal music, that it is sterile, static, boring, infantile, going nowhere. These charges are often made by critics enamored of the trajectories of tonal music with their archetypal plots of managed desire and its fulfillment. But there are other less predictable ways of being in the world. And African minimalism's way, with its underlying groove, its non-negotiable human presence, its disruption of an us and them performance arrangement, and its entangled temporalities, offers one such way. Now, there's more to be done on this topic. Of course, we might, for example, compare regional practices in order to achieve a better characterization of minimalist manners. We might also pursue further the comparison with Western minimalism, if only to show how the constraints imposed by dance in the African context ultimately mark its difference, which will also tell you why Africans can never dance to Steve Reich's music. In these and other instances, we will find again and again that while the material resources that enable African minimalism are modest, two or three pitches, a pair of contrasting timbres, or nuggets of distinctly shaped rhythmic patterns, the ingenuity and creativity displayed by performer composers are surely of the highest order, maximal rather than minimal. Thank you.
Does not the intervention of a trumpet, which is a Western classical instrument, Europeanize the minimalism or Americanize the minimalism within the African herb? Or would you say that the genre is not reliant on the instrumentation at all and it is reliant on the an African approach?
Yeah. See, I would be tempted to ask you, what do you think? but let me answer that, because I think one has to be very, very careful about material attributions when it comes to African music. In other words, you see a piece of metal and you say, well, okay, so maybe this is African, but you see a bugle and say, ah, this has to be from the outside. I'm not sure how productive it is nowadays to be thinking in terms of the specific, if you like, geographical or geocultural origins of these instruments. Obviously, it's what the instruments do, how they speak. That, to me, is more interesting. Now, the way that Bobobo emerged, you know, this is entertainment. This is urban entertainment music. In part, it's away from the big urban center. Okay, so these guys are sort of trying to do something that they know that the modern high life people are doing in the big cities where they have electricity and all of that. So there's a history there. And when the bugle was chosen, I mean, these are instruments left over from a previous period of mostly German and British occupation, if you like. It was just thought that the bugle made a big sound. You could just throw in there, and then everyone stops and freezes, and the guy does his big improvisation. I very much doubt that listeners to Bobobo would suddenly think that that moment meant that they had switched from an African style to a European style. Of course, these days when you say these things, there's somebody in the corner somewhere who will say, well, no, I feel that way, you know? And so we don't have a basis, but I think it's unlikely. Now, the situation is actually a little more complicated because Bobobo itself, I mean, is based, the singing in Bobobo often uses hymn tunes, for example, okay? But these hymn tunes have been around since the 1840s. And so the question of the nature of the sediment, you know, is, I think one can be lazy intellectually about thinking about sediments. You know, the easy way is just to say, well, it comes from here, it comes from here. So, you know, we allow these allegiances to sort of chain us. But I think it's a little more complicated than that, because people will use whatever is around to make a noise, whether they're stones, whether it's the leaf, whether it's a drum, whether, you know, and so on. So, sorry, I've gone on at length. Thank you for asking that question, but I just wanted to clarify that I would not say that somehow Bobobo is Europeanized because of that moment of the bugle coming in. And in fact, you'll see that, I mean, it arpeggiates up and does that, you know, trumpet call at the beginning, so that has some iconic value, but a lot of the rhythmic things. If you had heard the recording and you heard it with the drums, you would see, you know, when the unit 5, for example, where I was talking about the dialogue and the speech mode and so on. That's as African as those things come, if you want to speak in those terms. So, did I answer your question?
You have answered the question. Okay. Yes, it's, but your answer basically is the approach
Right.
Makes it African rather than the instrumentation.
Yeah.
The choice of instrument doesn't stigmatize or geographicize.
Well, it would not. It would almost certainly not stigmatize it from the performer's point of view. None of these performers is going to say, well, isn't it a shame that we're using a bugle that was brought by the Brits or by, you know, that question doesn't arise at all. I think if anything, it might be a cosmopolitan anxiety, you know, that, oh, that's too bad, they should have just stuck to the drums or something. But I answered at length because it seems to me that especially with material culture, one, I think, has to understand its precariousness and therefore treat the presence of instruments, I think maybe just with a little more care in terms of the kind of baggage that they're carrying.
I had trumpets in Nigeria.
Yes.
They're indigenous, sort of, those ones with the big
flap. Yeah, well, you say they're indigenous, and...
I don't know.
That's one way of thinking about them, but some of them may also have come from further north, from, you know, from Sudan and from Egypt and so on. Yeah. So
you could say it's something that's blown, isn't it? And that's the recyclable aspect of African culture, yeah. Including music. So it's pick up something that's already there. That's just. Because I think Western artists have done that as well, used, and there have been movements in art and culture that have been about using stuff, you know, like there's a whole movement of making music out of junk, you know,
yes.
Western rubbish really that's thrown away, and you can make music out of tubes and yeah. stuff like that. So I don't think it detracts from the Africanness. I think it's about... Because from what I've seen about African culture as a whole, it just take, you know, if things are left, and it has had a whole period of colonialism, so you have got a lot of death in Africa, including probably lots of metal. So it's just using what's over there. That's how recyclable.
My question is really to do with your basic strategy, which is to try and look at the origins, going back to colonialism. I'm just wondering whether... One aspect which you didn't mention, which I was interested whether you can expand on, would be the improvisatory element in music. And in Western minimalism, there was this sort of connection with experimental music, that it came out of that tradition, and the breaking up of the relationships between the performer and the audience. And to what extent, perhaps, is that derived? Or is there a channel of influence there that might come from improvisation in African music? Is it, to what extent is improvisation part of that, or am I missing? You didn't mention improvisation.
No, I didn't. And I'm not sure that I can give you a substantial answer, because improvisation in traditional African music is actually a very tricky concept, you know? My understanding of improvisation is that it very often, at least in some of the repertories that I was playing, is based on learned procedures. Okay, so you don't arrive empty-headed when you come to play. You arrive with a set of, there are ways of doing things, and then you decide what you want to do. You know, are you inspired by that dancer, or are you inspired by this person? So on. So there, then the sort of so-called composing in the moment can take a certain shape, but that is preceded by, you know, by a very deep awareness of a certain procedure. So there is error, for example, in improvisation. You can perform an Adwa piece, for example, and get it wrong. You know, somebody else thinks you're just improvising. So the African improvisatory, again, I'm sort of generalizing here, but what I would understand by improvisation is actually in some ways much more circumscribed. And now I grant that the versions of improvisation that you see through various Western minimalisms are also, they're varied, You know, so it's not just one kind of either written improvisation or one in which you order the motifs the way you want to order them and so on. That gets a little more complicated. But I guess I hadn't thought of that, that of making that connection. So that would be something to think about in as far as improvisation is concerned.
Kind of connect with the improvisations. I'm actually really interested in this trumpet solo. I'm going to have to find it because I've analysed a lot of Cuban flutes and some trumpet solos, and there's a lot of similarity. The bugle calls used a lot, and it's dominant to dominant, one octave tessitura. It's motivic development, it's very rhythmic, and I just wondered what the actual lineup was, because you mentioned Unit 5 had a break with the drums. Mm-hmm. And the collective kind of participatory element, mm-hmm. is very much, it just seems so similar, to all the solos that I've analysed. I'm just wondering, yes, what the actual lineup is for this, what the instrumentation is for this solo.
Oh, well, I mentioned there, or for the solo.
Yeah, so well, if there's a kind of break with the drums, it's fine.
Well, there's the lead drummer, okay, right. Or super master drummer. Then there are a couple of support drums. They're doing sort of fixed patterns for the... you're talking specifically about Unit 5. It'll be the lead drummer and the trumpeter.
So those are points where things come together, and I'd quite like to hear where you've got your waiting, kind of playing with the expectation side, whether that fits in with the drumming to a certain extent or not.
Yeah, sorry. Expectations for what? Sorry.
It struck me with when you talked about the waiting units, whether you're not sure how long he's going to stay on that before he goes back into his.
Well, the trumpet is going da-dum, 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 da-dum. He's looking at you and seeing whether you're enjoying yourself or whether you're bored, and then he may go ba-dum, ba-dum, you know, and he'll close suddenly. I mean, moments of closure are very often not some prolonged thing where, you know, infantile closing where everyone knows that we're going to close because we just hit the high point. But he'll say, oh, I'm taking it away. And you get a little bit of that. But that attitude of teasing and playing, that's very much part of the ethos.
It's very much part of the Cuban.
I think you're asking an important question, and really, if we were serious, we would analyze many, many of these improvisations, and then we would derive some kind of algorithm to explain them and so on. That's why.
Do you actually look at the signifying Henry Louis Gates side of things as well? Because the bugle calls like an opening call. He looks at Esuelig Bara and like the opener, and he starts his solo with the bugle call and finishes the ushers in the end as well.
Yeah.
Do you look at that?
I don't know how much of that weight lies behind the specific bugle call. I'll tell you that because a bugle, it plays only in a certain way, in a very limited way. So there's an archetypal sound that the bugle produces. And so when the bugle player pulls out his bugle, knows that this is the moment to do it, they are going to start with that archetypal, conventional sound, and then we all, you know, develop our goose pimples or whatever it is, or freeze, or, you know. And then he'll go on to essay his way through, you know, the motives as he sees them. So in terms of the baggage that he's bringing, I'm not sure that there's that much more baggage than, you know, this is what the bugle does. Let me step in, you know, and fan this performance with, you know, this thing, and then I will continue from
is
there.
Is it normally the trumpet in Bora?
Yeah, or the bugle. Yeah, trumpet or bugle.
Because
in
Cuban flute, you get bugle calls as well, and on other instruments, so that's kind of...
Yeah, it's usually one of those two. Yeah. And it doesn't have to be, you know, in great shape, the instruments. By the way, there's some very, very beaten...
Tunes overrated.
Yeah.
Did they execute the last one? Because they sounded as if they'd rehearsed it and they were playing as the chamber music.
The last
example.
Yeah.
It seemed like it wasn't improvised, was it? Because people were doing the same thing together and they knew they were together.
Oh. You mean at the very end of the improvisation?
The
Ghana,
number
10.
The
Pan African
Orchestra.
Oh, okay. You only heard an excerpt of it.
But there were two singers singing
okay,
together.
Okay. Yeah. So you're. How do we say it in English? I'll find the right mode. So the Pan African Orchestra is an orchestra founded by Nana Dansou Abiam that plays music that he himself claims authorship of, even though it sounds more traditional than traditional music, if you ask me. So some of it is composed. It's arranged. This is on a Pan recording. So this one is controlled. There are closing routines or closing gestures that can be used, for certain dances. So there are such things, depending on what the dance is. But these ones are composed. I mean, they have to fit on, a side of a recording. And so that specific one is very controlled in that sense, yeah.
I suppose the interesting thing, I know you did make some effort to address this. I feel a little bit sort of conflicted about whether or not it's even really appropriate to be using the idea of minimalism to be analysing this African material
mm-hmm.
in a cross-cultural, kind of comparative way, if only for the reason that Western minimalism seems to have been developed in dialogue with a lot of these repertoires already, that a lot of so-called minimalist composers weren't particularly keen on that term, and that even at the time it was called all kinds of other things, process music. And that also the way that material is developed in so-called Western minimalism still has vestiges of wanting to treat it as an abstracted kind of material that is put through a kind of process. And that in folk musics, I think it's much more unlikely or unusual to find an abstracted idea of musical material in itself. So to use a sort of art music designator like minimalism perhaps would sort of suggest that these musicians have an engagement with the music on a material level, perhaps, I don't know, maybe they do. And it'd be interesting to perhaps look at the pedagogy of the way this music is taught, how these musicians conceive of the, as you said, three different notes, only three notes used in a bugle solo.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, I felt conflicted for that reason. I'm not sure that the almost the aesthetic engagement with the material is done on the same level. So I don't know whether it's useful to even compare them.
Yeah, that's a good, I'm very glad you brought that point up. And I think it's an important point. It speaks to a bigger challenge, which is basically, how do we write about African music? When you compare any two things, you're going to ride roughshod over certain things, maybe undercomplicate some things. But let me just say that, and if you don't mind me putting it this way, from an African point of view, writing about African music almost always is writing against. Okay, the essential, I'm standing here addressing you in the English language, so obviously there's a lot of baggage that I'm bringing to bear. We have to communicate somehow. So we're writing against all the time in the sense that you're trying to figure out which of these things can I appropriate in order to draw attention to. That's all. Now the outcome of that drawing attention to, that's up to you. I want to think that it's a form of empowerment, right? But we don't have to get pious about that. All I'm saying is that there is a real challenge in terms of finding what is sufficiently suggestive to be able to draw on. Okay, now it seems to me that the environments of the sounds, if you abstract some of the xylophone stuff that I was playing, say, or some of the horn orchestras, the stuff that, Arome recorded in the Central Africa, if you just take the environments and compare those with certain Western minimalisms, there's absolutely no question about a similarity in the way that the environment is behaving. Now you're asking, well, what about the intentions and what about the pedagogical things, that are involved? And yeah, actually, it's not the case that the performers are not aware of any kind of process going on. Remember that these are performers who who, to be a genuine performer, you have to be able to do more than one thing, which means you have to be able to sing and play, sing and hear the other guy, and so on. So you're very aware of the stuff that's going on around you. These are very sophisticated musicians, you know. You may think you're just hearing taram, 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 but taram, taram is occurring in a context, and you're aware because something goes wrong and you realize what you're doing now means something different. Okay, so there are all these levels, I think, at work. But the simple answer to your question is that you may be right that I think minimalism, to use in a kind of blanket way, may be rough, right? On the other hand, it seems to me, and you know, if this wasn't clear, there's a kind of subtext here, because I think that the environments of a lot of these traditional African minimalist uses are in some ways much richer than some of the Western minimalists. I didn't say that because I didn't have the balls to do that today. but there's a subtext there. So let's first get you in the ring to discuss minimalism, and then we can take it from there, if you see what I mean. So there's a lot going on as far as representation is concerned, but I'm glad you picked up on that, because I certainly wouldn't claim that, you know, I found a ready label and I thought, great, you know, let's apply it. And I also, I did say at the beginning that the minimalism I was talking about has been implicit in African musical studies. So if you read Arome's big book on African polyphony and polyrhythm, for example, he spends a lot of time talking about minimal values, for example. So these timelines that will only have a short and a long, and so on. So we've been trading in minimalism for a very long time.
You try to draw comparison between the Western minimalism and how it is practiced in Africa. But in the Western minimalism, do you also include that movement in the 60s that was called like avant-garde or free jazz? Because, you know, you have this musician like the Art Ensemble of Chicago who are trying, they've tried to reenact or to maybe recapture that spirit of basic element of African music, such as repetitions, mm-hmm. and also minimalism in sound, or try to understand how the rhythm works. So what do you think, I mean, do you think they were successful in trying to maybe reproduce these archetypes? Because also, if you read some of the, let's say, Cage thought or comment on improvisation or what these people were doing, I mean, I don't know if it doesn't. Yeah. I mean, some of the stuff he said about them, and then I don't know how you can really
reconcile.
Yes, reconcile.
Yeah, a very quick answer to that is that the way the subjectivities that are on display, if you like, in the experimental music that you're talking about, to me are very different from the kinds of subjectivity that are on display in African minimalism. That's all.
Okay, well, let's thank Professor Agawu again.